Hey, hey, you're with Easy Jeezy. I made it back from my little sand trip, and it was great to drive this car back on the trailer unbroken, all I had to do was put gas in the tank and air in the tires, and this thing ran great. Here's what my trailer looks like when I'm hauling the buggy down the road. My little kitchen sink goes up against the wall. My tables and chairs fold up, the bed and everything, and it just makes for a nice little setup. And you know, when you're out there on the dunes as well as back home and with my channel, people are always asking me about horsepower and what kind of engines I recommend for what, and you know, this, that, and the other thing. And this is a 2276 with 9-to-1 compression and an Engel 120 can. It was built by somebody else. It was in the car when I bought it. It had a lot of oil leaks. I took it completely apart, CC'd the heads, looked at the bearings, and put it back together. I didn't even install new bearings. This thing has great, it just runs great. And you can see this aftermarket tin, and I'm sure if you look at different little places on it, there's spots that need attention. Those, it's just got so much air blowing. And this is aftermarket aluminum tin, and you know, things just don't fit that well. And I could silicone that in place, but I'm not sure. Maybe I'll put a tie wrap around here to hold that down closer and tighter. There's a few holes here and there. There's a couple of screws that vibrated out. I think there's one over here. There's always things to do when you get home from a trip like that. And I figured that 5 days running averaged about 40 miles a run, so that's about 200 miles the way I do my math, and I probably got less than 10 miles to the gallon, and that's what you get in those kinds of conditions. You're turning these big tires on soft sand and you're flopping around a lot of different angles. I have two oil filters. I have one on the pump, and I have another one here on a oil cooler that goes from the stock oil cooler location, goes through the filter, through the oil cooler, and back down to the main bearings. And that seems to be working so far, and hopefully it'll keep on doing that. I'm not going to spend any money on this car. I'm not going to try to beautify it. It has a brush painted paint job. The old boy I bought this car from was 78 years old. He told me that before I went and looked at it. He said, "Doesn't have no fancy paint job. It's just brush painted." And I said, "That's okay." And he said, "The engine don't run right. There's something the matter with one of the carburetors, and I don't know how to tune it. I've got the book." And, you know, I went over and looked at it, and when I got it home, I put these other carburetors on it, these little 36s. I think it had 45 Delortos. We'll have to take a look at that. And one of these days I might, I got the stuff I needed to repair it. So one of these days I might have to do a video on it. But you know how it is when things are running good. You hate to disturb anything. You know, you don't want to mess with it if it's running good. So there's no secret to performance and horsepower with these type of engines, the same as an American V8. It's, you know, more fuel in and getting it out and having a good hot spark and the right compression for the type of fuel you're running. That's the secret. And you know, there's no substitute for displacement. With an American, you know, I'm going to talk like the traditional engines. I'm a kid from the 60s. I got my driver's license in the 60s, and I'm retired now. And boy, that was the heyday. Of course, there's all these horsepower wars and things, and you know, you could get a 57 Chevy and get a junkyard V8 and put in there, and man, it just ran great. Get a 4-speed transmission, and you'd be bashing gears and having a good old time. I had a 67 Mustang with a 390 and a 4-speed in it from the factory. I didn't have to do any of the wrenching. Henry Ford did that for me. And again, displacement was the key. And, you know, all of them had their little things that you could do over and above what the factory did. And people ask me all the time, you know, they're looking for that $25 to $100 item that they can bolt onto their Volkswagen engine and just magically improve the performance. And, you know, you might be just leaving a lot of horsepower on the table by not maximizing what you have. Nothing like a good tune-up. I say step into the current technology and go with electronic pointless ignition. I like the Petronix brand, but there's a lot of good ones out there. I've had two people that I know with electronic ignition fail and be stranded on the side of the road, and I usually carry an extra distributor with me. If I'm going to go a long ways from home, I mean, you got a cell phone, right? And you can call and have somebody pick you up for most stuff if you're just running around back and forth to work and school. But if you're going over the road or a long ways from home or where there's not going to be any people or cell service, I always take a distributor and some tools with me. So that's something to keep in mind. But I still think it's the way to go because it's going to be, your timing is going to be spot on, you know. And that's important if you want to maximize the horsepower that you got. The Baja. When I bought the Baja, you know, it was beat up pretty bad. And I spent some time, you know what? It's been 5 years that I've had the Baja because I just had to renew the license plates and we have to get 5 year stickers. I can't believe that much time has gone by. And by far, this is my most used and probably favorite car of the lot for year-round use. It's not specialized. And that, in fact, is why I have so many of these darn things. If I want to play in the sand, which is very exciting and thrilling and fulfilling for me and addictive, I'm going to have the car that's going to be able to do that. And that's what I got that desert race car for. And it was cheaper for me to buy the whole car than it was to build that type of an engine. This Baja runs a 2-liter engine. 1 year I drove it 10,000 miles and I just love that 2-liter engine. You can run the heater boxes on it and it will, a stock valve heads, 78 stroke crank, 90.5 pistons, and stock valve heads with stock heater boxes and dual throat Weber carburetors on it. I have no idea what horsepower it makes. And it's got a very mild cam in it. It's not even an Engel 100. And I had ratio rockers on it for several years and then started breaking rocker arm studs and was measuring it. And turned out I had I thought I ordered a stock cam and I was going to run ratio rockers on a stock cam, but what happened was they sent me a cam and it didn't have no markings on it, and I put the ratio rockers on it and I was getting 530 thousandths lift on my valves, and that was just too much for the kind of springs that I had. This is a stock sedan. It's my car, but it was my son's. He bought it from the original owner, and it's been all around this country. Currently, it's living at my house. I redid the engine, put a stock cam on it, stole his 36 DeLordos, and put a stock carburetor on this. But that stock cam, this thing has more power than stock, and it runs fine. And it's that displacement thing. You know, I've got more displacement. It's a 1776 instead of a 1600. And if you've ever driven a 1500 and compare it to a 1600, you know you can feel the difference, and you can feel that same difference when you get into this car. And depends on what gears you're running in your transmission, too. Those old cars had a 437 ring and pinion. Then they switched in 66 to a 412. And so those things all come into play as well. Now, 2 years ago, I built this 1800 here, and that was a 74-stroke cam in a stock block, and I wanted to try those 88 slip-in pistons. I put it in that car. For whatever reason, I put these big valve Magnum heads that used to be on my 2110. I ordered some new heads. They were too fancy and ported out too far. I didn't want to put them on a street motor that I was going to jump in and go across country in. So I put these Magnum 44s on there that had 40 by 35 stainless valves, and I run the heater boxes on them, and I ran it really hard for a really long time on the interstate, and I think I did something because it lost a little power by the time I got back home, and it was running hotter as well. So I think what the old school guys warned you about is true. You know, if you're not running those stock valve heads, the heater boxes must go. I got a squeal issue here. I'm not sure which one it is, but it's aggravating me. I'm gonna take my brake shoes out and put some of that squeal stop on them and scuff them up a little bit, and that should take care of that. But this buggy is running a 2110. I want to get inside that 1800 and see what's going on, and so I took my old 2110 and put it in here. This thing is as old as dirt, runs great. I've got a C35 scat cam in it. I lowered the compression in it. I've got some really cool heads on it from AA Piston. They sell some really nice heads and did a nice job for me. I think it was better to put those heads on this 2110 than that 1800, and that's what I did. And I wanted to see how they work, and I put it in this car and I never took it out. And you know, usually I would run this 2110. This was my big performer, and I just didn't leave it in. I didn't want to put a lot of miles on it and wear it out just going back and forth to work and running 2 miles over to the grocery store and so on and so forth. So I just, you know, took it out, and I was running that little 1800. And I think I'm going to leave this 2110 in it, and I'm going to take it down to Arizona this winter, and I want to do some exploring on that Arizona Peace Trail. And you can Google that, Arizona Peace Trail. It's supposed to be a 750-mile loop of dirt, connecting dirt trails and roads through the backcountry from Bullhead City to Yuma, Arizona. And Quartzsite would be the middle of that, making it sort of like a figure eight. And it sounds really cool. I wanna do that. And I got a friend who's got a similar car, and we may be posting up some videos of us doing that together. And I'm really excited about that. So I'm going to be leaving the sand car home this winter and taking this with me down to Arizona. It's going to be fun to have this. It's street legal. Drive around on the streets. It's beautiful in the wintertime down there. And that's what we're going to do. And I hope you'll stay with me. Appreciate y'all coming back. Thanks for watching. Thanks for subbing. Easy Jeezy out.
It's that cloud of dust. Easy Jeezy gone.